Today we're going to go through some ways that might help you improve your army lists in Warhammer 40K. Hello and welcome back to Auspex Tactics, the strategy-focused 40K channel, where we're all about getting the most out of our miniatures on the tabletop. Now, as we all know, list building is a major skill in Warhammer 40K. Player skill is also very important, but it's absolutely the case that if you bring a far stronger list to the table, then you have a far higher chance of winning if everything else is equal. I personally also find it really quite a fun area of the game as well, playing around with different tactics and strategies and try and make things work and theorycraft some new ideas. I'm sure there's more than a few who are listening who have 50 plus lists saved somewhere on Battlescribe or a Word document, and they get continually added to as new updates for the game come out. In this video, we'll talk through some of the principles of list building, with a few specific pointers to increasing efficiency. So without further talking, let's get into it. So before you even start to sit down and write things out, it's worth considering the medium that you're writing it in. Flipping back and forward between codex pages can take a lot of time. I do honestly recommend Battlescribe, and things like the datasheets on Warhammerpedia can also be useful. Games Workshop really don't make it easy to build army lists with the codexes as they are. Most units have multiple different wargear options, and it's very easy to miss things and accidentally undercost your models if you're not super familiar with the ones that you're fielding. That's why I find it can save a lot of time to use Battlescribe or Warhammerpedia, where they have the points cost listed on the datasheet. I really hope at some point they manage to release something that fixes this for 40k. In this day and age, you wouldn't think it'd be too hard. When we actually come to writing the list, a lot of this will seem perfectly intuitive, but I think it's worth clarifying each step in your mind, as it allows you to think a little bit about how they might each be improved. First of all, when we write an army list, we have to think about what sort of core idea we'd want to make work, whether that idea is, I want to try and use the models that I have in my collection to form the most efficient list that will win me the most games, or I'd like to run Imperial Guard at this tournament, I don't mind buying a few models for it, what's the best I can come up with? Or even set yourself a bit of a self-imposed limit, like I want to run Black Templars in Land Raider Crusaders. I know it's not necessarily the most optimal thing, but it fits the fluff and the aesthetic, and I want to try and make it work as efficiently as possible. If you're looking at it purely from a gaming perspective, you might be trying to make a specific rule or mechanic work, say that I want to build a Chaos Possessed bomb list, where we throw loads and loads of buffs on one big unit of Possessed and use them to tear up whatever they touch. Hopefully we might be going over that list sometime later this week. Once you've got your core idea down, you need to think about how that's actually going to translate into winning a game of 40k. Generally, the two main ways that you win are via board control and holding objectives versus killing the enemy's army and wiping them off the table. Pretty much all armies will have an element of both of these, being able to hold some objectives while hopefully removing enemy units. But you really can go very far in either direction. A good board control list might be a plague bearer horde with 200 plague bearers or something. It won't necessarily deal tons of damage, but it should clog up most of the objectives for most of the game. Where a list with a lot of killing power but maybe not quite as much board control might be something like Eldar Flyer Spam, where they really struggle to hold objectives barring a few ground-based units, but that doesn't always necessarily matter too much if they use their decent firepower to hoover the other army off the board in short order. Both of these can certainly work and be strong, though it might be best to try and tailor it a little bit to what sort of event or rule set you're thinking of using. Say if you were attending a tournament and there was a heavy emphasis on scoring points for removing enemy units, it might make more sense to focus on the killing side of things, rather than trying to go all in on objective scoring. From there, I'd start with trying to put down the list that are the basis of your core idea. These are hopefully going to be your main battle line type units, the ones that are going to be pretty efficient at taking and receiving damage, or are going to have the durability or mobility to score all the objectives. These would be the units that you absolutely want to include in your army. For example, for a fairly traditional looking guard list, you might think about getting a whole bunch of infantry and a few Lehman Russ tanks, as they're both very durable and the Lehman Russes can deal a fair bit of damage. For the Black Templars, I'd start by putting in the Land Raider Crusaders and maybe some of their contents. And for the Possessed Bomb, obviously we'd include the big unit of Possessed. Maybe think about a few of the most key or synergy characters that you want to support them. At this sort of stage, I'd usually be thinking about the main synergies for your army. In general, in 40k, the units that you're using are typically okay just by their base profiles, but the vast majority of the strongest things happen when you combine powerful units with powerful upgrades and support, whether they're auras from buffing characters, psychic powers, powerful stratagems, or things like chapter tactics or regiment traits. If your core idea was to use a whole bunch of Lehman Russ demolishers and capitalize on their awesome anti-tank firepower outputs, You might think about making your army primarily a Vostroian one to get the extra 6-inch range on those guns. And also at this point, I think about any characters that are going to be pretty much an auto-include. Maybe deciding that your warlord trait is going to be a warlord with old grudges to allow them to reroll wounds against one target. And perhaps thinking about including them in the Emperor's Fist tank company. I think it's just usually helpful to get the core damage dealing component of your army sorted before you go starting looking at some of the extra parts of your list. After you've put down your first few units, I start thinking about looking at the offense of your units and the defense, the damage they can take. In general, in army lists, it's usually going to be better to have a homogenized defense, which is basically me using fancy language to describe having a whole ton of similar defensive profiles across your army. In general, your opponent's going to be armed with a mix of, say, anti-tank and anti-infantry weapons. They're not going to take all of one or the other. So in general, it's likely to be a little bit easier for them to take out an army that has a mix of tanks and infantry. If you have the vast majority of your army in tanks, then anti-infantry firepower is likely to be wasted. And the same if you take a massive horde, say that plaguebearer horde we were talking about. You've basically made their investment in anti-tank weapons somewhat redundant, as they won't be able to do anything efficient. This is one of the reasons why spam is quite so good in pretty much most war games. It doesn't have to all be of the same unit either. You could take a whole load of Lehman Russes and artillery, for example, and they're all tough vehicle targets, meaning that when the opponent can only remove one or two of them per turn, the rest of your army is going to be shooting back at pretty good efficiency. It's why you often see lists that are like fairly themed, so you might get things like Eldar Flyer Spam, that's Iron Hands Intercessor list that's going around, or things like Dark Eldar with a ton of Venoms and Ravagers and stuff. If you only present the opponent with one lot of defensive profile, then any weapons that aren't efficient against that are going to be underperforming. I find you can also think about the defense of your army on a per turn basis as well. For example, if you have the option to put a load of units in reserve, you could have a whole load of your units hang back turn one and present almost no targets to the enemy, really frustrating their damage output. Then in your turn, you could potentially do a big counterattack if you have good mobility, kind of getting the jump on them. And if you expose a lot of threats turn two all at once, the enemy's firepower isn't going to be able to cope with all of them, and likely some are going to be able to get through. You can absolutely build this into your army list as well, thinking I will have all these threats come down turn two. The opponent's capacity to deal with them is going to be overloaded, and some of these very scary units are going to get through to be able to do their damage output. Blood Angels could be a reasonable army where this could work. Maybe deploy a whole load of scouts on the board turn one. Maybe a unit that you can jump across the board with on Wings of Fire, and then have that unit come down with other units from Deep Strike and hit the enemy on multiple fronts all in one big turn. And hopefully after that they won't be able to deal with all of the jump-packed marines that are in their deployment zone. In terms of your army's offensive damage output, in general you'd want to have things that are going to be able to deal decent damage to any sort of army that you come across. As we've just said, you could be playing either a horde of plaguebearers or some Eldar Flyers, and not all that much does decent damage to both of those targets. You're going to need a reasonable amount of anti-infantry for the plaguebearers, and a reasonable amount of anti-vehicle weapons, maybe with good ballistic skill, to take out the Eldar Flyers. It doesn't have to be ranged weapons either. You could have most of your anti-tank tied up in very fighty combat units, such as Blood Angel Smash Captains, for example. But in general, most good lists are going to be able to do decent damage to the both of them. I find I often see competitive lists that have units that can deal decent damage to either tanks or infantry, as it just makes them a lot stronger and more flexible, and it means that your opponent can't just delete the part of your army that's most threatening to them. Say, for example, if you were playing against the Eldar Flyers, you had three great anti-air units, and thus the army was useless against them, the Eldar Flyer player could possibly just kill those three anti-air units turn one, and give you a very bad game for the rest of the game. For this reason, sometimes it can be useful to use a bit more general purpose units, things like Repulsor Executioners, Invicta Tactical Warsuits, Leon Rust Battle Tanks, things that can inflict some decent damage to both tanks and infantry. Unit upgrades are an interesting one with army list construction. In general, newer players tend to go a little bit heavy on the upgrades, particularly as there's quite a lot available in Warhammer 40K, things like power weapons on squad leaders, and special and heavy weapons and standard infantry units. All of these can certainly have their place in the right list, but they're often a little bit less efficient than just including more bodies in the infantry, and perhaps investing the save points into actual decent efficient damage dealers. Obviously this will vary case by case and army by army, but for example for Imperial Guard, I tend to find that the infantry squads are usually just best to leave as pretty cheap squads with las guns, just focus on anti-infantry and screening, and put all of that saved points over the course of a list into an extra tank or two. In particular, things like power weapons on standard infantry squads aren't usually all that efficient, particularly if it's a ranged infantry squad that aren't really going to be wanting to get into close combat, so the power weapon just gives you a few mediocre hits, in a pretty worst case scenario. So often I find that they aren't particularly the best buy, particularly as they're often pointed the same as if you'd armed them for characters who can use them a lot better. I think they kind of fall into the category of units and upgrades that either only really help you when you're basically already winning a game, or only help you a bit when you've kind of already lost a game and things are going very badly and they're unlikely to come back anyway. Power weapons on guard squads and commanders usually mean that you've managed to get them into close combat, which isn't really where they want to be for the most part, meaning that you've likely invested points for a situation where either the actual squad or unit is pretty much dead anyway, or because your whole battle line has been engaged in close combat, might mean that you've lost the whole game. So after you've focused on the core of your army, and maybe thought a little bit about the defensive profile of your units and being able to take out enemy units, there's quite a few nice-to-haves in Warhammer 40k that you're unlikely to be able to have all of in one list, but they might help out against certain matchups or take your list to the next level in other areas. The main first consideration are command points. Pretty much every army will want some, and most of the time it is going to be worth filling out at least one battalion with 2 HQs and 3 troops to get an additional 5 more. Some armies can fill out battalions very easily, both in terms of having cheap HQs and troops, but also the ones that really want to be having a lot of HQs and troops anyway can find it very easy to fill battalions just by taking what they would have taken anyway. Things like orcs, for example, who are generally going to want a fair few boys squads and have very decent support HQ characters. Obviously more command points are better, but some lists can get on just fine without many at all. Things like those Eldar Flyers, or one of my Master Artisan's Stealthy Iron Hands lists that did quite well at tournaments, where basically you just ignore troops and just take all the heaviest weapons that you possibly can, to hopefully just obliterate the opponent's army off the board as quickly as possible, at the price that you pay of having a few less fancy command points to do some tricks with. In general, command points are diminishing returns, so having, say, 2 battalions is a lot more valuable than paying for that third one as well, as you'll already have the command points to do your most important tricks, and the other ones are a bit more extra. How many battalions or even brigades that you want to pay for will kind of depend on the exact army that you're playing, how much value they can get out of their command points, versus how cheap it is to fill out those detachments. And just as an aside, once you've completed a list, always make sure if you're going to fill out, say, an additional spearhead or vanguard detachment or something with the spare units that are in your battalions, as that can be a very easy way to conjure up a free command point from nothing once you've already finished writing your list. Next up, screening and objective scoring units are really quite handy to have around. The vast majority of armies have these at least to some extent, because if you don't have screening units, then a lot of the units in 40k come in from Deep Strike Reserve, jump down and deal horrendous damage if they're left unchecked to get into the core of your army. Having a few units of sacrificial troops on the outskirts of the army can be great, whether it's Imperial Guard Squad, Space Marine Scouts, or Orc Gretchen. They can often add a huge value to your list if they protect your bigger, more expensive units from being torn to bits. And again, with the command points, there is somewhat of a diminishing returns after you have a fair few of these. For example, if you had a guard tank list, then the first 3 infantry squads that you add to that list would be absolutely amazingly useful in terms of their value, and then adding more and more might start to get you a little bit less value as you go along. So it's one that's worth striking the balance in general. You can certainly have too few and allow the opponent to get right to the core of your army very quickly, which could lose you games. But I think you can have too many as well if you invest loads and loads of points in chaff screens. Then you might sacrifice the main hitting power of your army and ability to deal damage to the opponent. These of course have nice synergy with filling out troops and battalions, so including a few units of basic troops can both net you more command points and also fill this niche. Next, and a bit more niche, are scouting or advanced move type units, things like Space Marine Scouts that can set up outside their deployment zone, Chaos Nurglings, or perhaps things like Imperial Guard Sentinels that can move outside their deployment zone before the game starts. These guys certainly aren't essential, but they're pretty handy to have around. They can be really great for keeping the enemy at arm's length, taking midfield objectives, and also stopping your opponent's similar units from getting to ground in the midfield. Say, for example, if you're setting up first, you could block out a lot of the deployment zone with Space Marine Scouts, so if the enemy had Invict Tactical Warsuits, which can also do this and are very threatening, they'd have to deploy them a fair way away from your army. Good to have if you can get them. Next up we have Psychic Defense. Some races certainly do better with this than other ones. but again it will mean that the first psyker that you add to your army has a bit more value than the next, as it does give you at least one crucial deny for trying to stop that key power of your opponent's army from going off. Of course, psychic defence isn't relevant in a lot of matchups. A lot of armies don't even use psykers, so in my opinion, unless a lot of your meta are psykers, then it's not worth getting too hung up about, and some armies can do absolutely fine without it. But again, it's a nice to have. Flexible units that can do different things depending on what sort of opponent you're facing are good too. For example, if you had some Space Marine Assault Centurions that were Raven Guard, they could either start on the board or be dropped in via Deep Strike Reserve via their stratagem, so give you some flexibility as to how you play them. Most of the time you might be planning to Deep Strike them, but occasionally against slow-moving hordes where their Hurricane Bolters are going to be the main thing that you need out of them, it might not be the worst to start them on the board and get them shooting right from turn one. In rule sets that allow you to pick things like Litanies and Psychic Powers after you've seen your opponent's army list, then this can also be a great way to tailor somewhat to the army you're facing, such as, say, having a psychic power that has both a power that's good against debuffing big units like knights, or a mortal wound dealing power that could deal a lot of damage to hordes, and you could pick the one that you needed most for the right situation. Long range and ignore line of sight weapons are incredibly helpful to have in an army list, as they can provide a lot of counter to your opponent hiding units in cover, or just putting them at the back of the map to prevent your army from interacting with them. At least having a few of these can really help deal with the one or two threats that are hard to get to, whether that's trying to take out a fragile Imperial Guard heavy weapons team at the back of the map that's got decent firepower but very weak defensively, or just trying to take out that last troop that's hiding on an objective out of line of sight could well be the difference between gaining or losing a whole ton of victory points. This is why you will see a lot of competitive lists have ignores line of sight firepower such as Thunderfire Cannons, Whirlwinds, Smart Missile Systems, or Guard Artillery in them. Another alternative to trying to get these hard-to-reach threats are to have some extreme fast movers in your army. Things like Eldar Shining Spears or Flyers can be great for this. With enormous amount of movement, you might be able to get all the way to those units just literally by moving there, then either deal damage to them or maybe tie them up in close combat to try and take them out of the game. It can be worth paying a premium for such units, just because it allows you to apply the force exactly where you need to in the opponent's army to make them yield victory points, maybe dealing significant blows to their ability to damage you. Chaos Helldrakes are actually a great example of this as well. Mediocre damage dealing, but really, really long range movement, which makes them a decently strong option in my opinion. Like I say, all of these are nice to haves. Most lists aren't going to be able to do all of these, and the ones that do are probably sacrificing damage output from their most efficient units. So you really need to think about which ones of these that you most need in your army, and weigh that up against the loss of firepower that you might have from sacrificing your main damage dealers. Next, and perhaps most importantly, having borne all of this in mind, you really need to think about what sort of game you're going to be playing. Firstly, what's good in 40k really does vary depending on what other people are playing. This is the meta. If everyone's playing Space Marines at the moment, then you're going to be rewarded for bringing along high AP multi-damage weapons to better cut through those power armor and multi-wound Primaris infantry. If the new hotness is orcs and everyone's running 200 orc boys, then you're going to be wanting more anti-infantry weapons. It makes complete sense, but I found it's a really good idea to think about the top lists at the moment and how your list might be able to handle those. And if you really have no answers to one of the strongest lists around, it might well be worth trying to rethink some things, so at least you have some sort of chance in that matchup. Then we touched on this before, but I'll mention it again. It really is important to think what sort of mission pack you're playing, whether you know you're playing Maelstrom or Eternal War, might encourage you to take different numbers of fast-moving units, or units that are going to be stronger at surviving till the end of the game. Or if you're playing ITC with the secondaries they have, there's a whole raft of units that are either better or worse, depending on how easily they give up secondaries. If you can write a list that's very strong against the top armies at the moment, and also good for the rule set that you're going to be playing, then you might well be onto a winner. Finally, after all this is done, you've got your list sorted. Spend those last few additional points in increasing the squad size of some units or applying some upgrades where you think you're going to get the most value in addition to what you already have. And then it's time to try and practice and actually get some games in with it. Theory Hammer's all well and good, but it's important to try and apply this to actual real-world games, as very rarely does any plan survive perfectly with contact with the enemy, particularly in Warhammer 40k, when you could be facing some very different armies across the other side of the table, and typically even the same list can be played very differently against different opponents. I wouldn't be too quick to either drop anything or change your list up each time you play. 40k is a very random game, and in some games some of your units are going to be absolutely useless just because of what you're facing on the other side of the table. If you've brought a whole load of anti-tank weapons and you happen to be facing off against a horde, those anti-tank weapons aren't going to do much, but it doesn't mean that they don't have to be in your list, because if you happen to be facing a tank line next, then you'd be pretty much in trouble without any anti-tank guns. I try and remain a bit dispassionate about your units as well, in terms of looking to improve. Just because one of your units did something epic in one game doesn't necessarily mean they're going to do it again if the dice roll a bit more averagely. I look at what they can achieve over a whole bunch of games before deciding that they're absolutely the bee's knees and need to be in every one of your army lists. I try and run a lot of games with a fairly similar army list and maybe just swap out a few specific options, get the balance of screening and damage dealers right, or maybe add some of the other nice-to-haves in to see if they make it stronger overall. Warhammer 40k is definitely an inexact science. Realistically, just from the amount of games that we play, any one player isn't likely to acquire enough data to really understand and make great decisions on which units are best and which units aren't. There's so many different things that they could be facing, and there's so many different ways that you could run them against the things that you are facing. So the more practice and trial and error that you can do once you have a core idea established, the better it will likely get over time, and the more disciplined you'll get in actually fielding your list and making it actually perform to maximal efficiency. So I hope that's been of some help to you. I know that some of this was a little bit abstract, but actually trying to logic out the steps that most people go through fairly intuitively kind of shows there are a lot of decisions to be made when you go into writing an army list. If you've got any other tips or tactics, please let us all know in the description down below. It'd be great to have a read. And if you've enjoyed this video, feel free to subscribe to Auspex Tactics, where we have regular 40k content coming out every day. If you have been enjoying the videos on this channel, I do have a Patreon page, which is what keeps them coming. It takes quite a long time making these videos, and I do release 2 a day, so a fair bit of effort's been put in, and it's only possible to dedicate this effort away from my regular job due to the generous supporters on Patreon. So if you are enjoying these regularly, any support is greatly appreciated, and I'll most certainly be keeping the videos coming. A big thank you for listening, and I'll hope to see you guys next time.